see here in this particular slide, we are in unit 3 and so we have completed some part which is dimmed here, and the separator design we are going to discuss in little detail. And in the previous classes also we have discussed separator design, where we evaluated the liquid capacity and gas capacity of the separator, and these are the two very important parameters. Or when you go to any vendor, he will ask, okay, these two things, that what is the liquid capacity and what is the gas capacity, and for this you must have the sufficient information to tell the vendor to get the separator of different sizes, right? So these two quantity need to be evaluated, and we'll see how this will evaluate this liquid capacity and gas capacity. Although we have seen some calculation, but these calculation require some density parameters, and this density parameter can be calculated using flash calculations, right? So not only density parameter, we'll evaluate different fractions of component present in the separator in gaseous form and in liquid form. So we'll see as we go along. Right now, you see, first we'll discuss the concept of stage separation, and then we'll go to flash calculation. So can you tell me, why do we need this stage separation, any one of you?
Because first we have to separate the liquid from the gas, and then we have to separate the oil from the water.
That is okay. Do you know the concept of stage separation? Stage, why do we need one or two separators sometimes?
No, sir.
Okay. Now see, stage separation is generally required when you want to get most of the liquid from your separation, right? So in some cases you need only two stage separator, in some case one separator can work, and in certain cases we need three stage separation. So stage separation can be said as a process in which the hydrocarbon mixture are separated into vapor and liquid phases by multiple equilibrium flashes. So each equilibrium flash will occur in a single separator, right? And then if you have different stages, then it's called multiple equilibrium flashes, and constant at consequently lower pressure. So as you go along in each separation stage, your pressure is going to reduce, right? Now a two stage separation require one separator and a storage tank. As you can see here, I have just located here in this figure. So this is one separator and this is other separator, right? So storage tank is also act as a separator. So this is called two stage separation, where one is the separator and one is the storage tank, where you are going to store as a stock tank barrel, right? Now in three stage separation, you require two separators and a storage tank. So these are the two separators and one storage tank is there, right? So this is the typical three stage, and this is called two stage, right? And a storage tank is always counted as a final stage of vapor liquid separation. So this is the final stage, this stage in both the cases. So this is the final stage of liquid separation, vapor liquid separation. Now this stage separation reduces the pressure in steps or stages, right? So every time you go from one separator in this direction, right? So here the pressure is higher, here it is little lower, and then it is here, it is around atmospheric, right? So every time as you go along, you are going to reduce your pressure and resulting in most stable stock tank liquid. Usually a stable stock tank liquid can be obtained by stage separation of not more than four stages, right? So typically it has seen from the experience that these two stage separator and three stage separator are useful, right, in increasing the amount of liquid that you are going to produce. And if you are increasing the stages further, right, so if you want to increase the stage from three to four, suppose, Right. So in that case, you are not going to gain much liquid out of it. However, you will add up to the additional cost. So that is not actually desirable. So this two-stage and three-stage separator are generally recommended, not more than that. So in high pressure gas condensate separation, a stepwise reduction of pressure on the liquid condensate can significantly increase the recovery of stock tank liquid. This is the actual thing that we want. We want more and more liquid to come out, and therefore we need to increase our more and more stages, right? So next is the prediction of the performance of various separator in multi-stage separation system can be carried out with computer models using the initial well stream composition, the operating temperature and pressure. So this is more about the flash calculation that I am talking about. That in flash calculation, we have the initial well stream which is coming out of the choke or well. And because of this operating temperature and pressure, these composition is going to change in the form of gas and liquid. So the performance of separator depends on the stages of separation, and this can be modeled by various computer simulations. We'll see how we'll calculate that. Now coming to some general aspect of stage separation, where you'll see that 3 to 4 stage, as I discussed, 3 to 4 stage of separation theoretically increase the liquid recovery over a 2-stage separation. So the liquid recovery is going to increase if you add up to the number of stages, like from 2-stage to 3-stage, the liquid recovery is going to increase. And the incremental liquid recovery that you are getting out of the stage separation rarely pays out you, right? So the amount of liquid that you recovered, if you sell in the market, that will not give you the cost of additional separator. So that is actually a loss. Okay, so you need to optimize the kind of separation or stage separation. And it has been generally recognized that the 2-stage of separation plus the stock tanks are practically optimum, right? So 2 stages of separation is generally recognized as optimum condition. And the increase in liquid recovery for 2-stage separation over a single stage separation usually varies from 2 to 12%. Sometimes it go up to 20% also. Okay. Now, how decide the operating pressure of each stages in the separation, right? So suppose you have 1, 2, or 3 stages. It depends on your judgment. And suppose the first stage separator operating pressure is generally determined by the flow line pressure. So the flow line pressure that is coming from the well, right? That is a flow line pressure, or the pressure just out of the choke and which is directly going into the separator. So at that particular point of time, what is the pressure? And that pressure is actually deciding the pressure of the first separator, right? And usually the pressure in the first separator is from 600 to 1200 psi. Now, in some cases, it may happen that the pressure, inlet pressure, is more than 600 psi, right? So in that cases, it is practical to let the first stage separator to operate at the flow line pressure, right? So if the flow line pressure is suppose 1200 psi, so it will operate at 1200 psi, right? Now, in 1976, Campbell has come up with empirical correlation where you would like to find out the pressure ratio, right? And as we know that the pressure ratio in each stages will remain same, right? So this RP is nothing but the pressure ratio. You can see equation down below that this RP is the pressure ratio, and P1 is the initial pressure in the first separator, and PS is the pressure in stock tank condition, right? So as you can see here, we have 3 different separators, and each separator, it has the first separator has got pressure P1, and in this separator the pressure is PS. So in this way the RP is calculated, And NST is the number of stages, right? So if you have 2-3 stages, you just put it here and then get the value of RP. And suppose you have the value of RP now. So using this equation in the right hand side, you see PI equal to PI minus 1 divided by RP. If you want to find out the pressure in the second separator, so the P2 is equal to P1 divided by RP. So in this way, you can find out the pressure in each stages. Okay, so this is given by Campbell in 1976, and this is a very useful equation in pressure design of pressure vessels. Now coming to the most important part, as I said, that if you go to any vendor, he will ask that what is the liquid capacity and the gas capacity. Now you have a condition that a gaseous stream is coming and it has to be separated. Now that stream is having a sufficient quantity of hydrocarbon. Now that is going to separate, and once it is going to separate, you have some liquid which is going to separate and some gas that is going to separate out, right? So from a single well stream, you need to separate a liquid and you need to separate gas. So at the down you have liquid, at the top you have gas. Now based on the composition of well stream fluid, the quality of product from each stage of separation can be predicted by flash calculation. Now what does it mean? It means that if you know the composition of the well fluid, right? So the composition of well fluid can be determined by gas chromatography, and the quality of product, I mean to say, what is the gas that is going to flash and what is the liquid that is going to flash, determine the quality of product that you are getting, right? And it depends on the composition of the well fluid, it depends on the pressure conditions within the separator. And note that it is assumed that the phase equilibrium are reached in the separator. So once the phase equilibrium are reached in the separator, we require the knowledge of equilibrium ratio as defined below. So now you can see here that KI is the equilibrium ratio. And this equilibrium ratio we have to calculate first before doing any kind of flash calculation. So this KI value is very, very important, and this need to be calculated before we do any kind of phase flash calculation. So as we go along, we see that we use some kind of laws called Dalton's law and Rolle's law to find out this KI. And if the pressure is higher, sufficiently higher than 100 psi, then we go for some empirical correlation given by standing, right? So as of now, here we want to develop some background knowledge for flash calculation, right? So Omar, Dhaval,
yes sir,
are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes sir.
And I'm audible also?
Yes.
Okay, so let's move now, right?
Yes.
Now we need to have some background knowledge for flash calculation. Now this background knowledge, I mean to say, we want to know about what is phase, right? So first I define the phase here. Now you know the phase is defined as a part of system that is uniform in physical and chemical properties. So when you say something as a phase, it should be uniform in physical and chemical properties. It should be homogeneous in composition and separated from other coexisting phases by a definite boundary, right? So this is defined as phase. And in hydrocarbon system, as you see, the most important phase occurring in petroleum production are the hydrocarbon phase and the gaseous phase, which coexist in equilibrium. So we can define as liquid phase and gaseous phase. Now it is the temperature, pressure and the composition that determines the equilibrium, right? Always the pressure, temperature and composition are the variables which are going to determine the equilibrium condition that is occurring inside the separator, right? So the amount of liquid or amount of gas that is getting phased out depends on the pressure, temperature, and composition of the valley stream. So composition of the valley stream is important, and the temperature and pressure inside the separator is important to determine the equilibrium of the phases, right? I mean to say liquid phases and gaseous phases. The condition under which these different phases can exist are the matter of considerable practical importance in designing of surface separation facility and developing compositional model. So every time I am stressing that these different phases which are going to phased out or are going to flash from the incoming fluid stream are very important, because we are having the quality of product that is getting produced from that phases, and therefore it is of very practical importance that what we are going to get out of that valley stream depending on the pressure and temperature in the separator condition, right? And such type of calculations are generally called equilibrium ratio calculations, or concept of equilibrium ratio, right? So let's move along. Now, the other concept that we need in understanding the flash calculation is the vapor pressure, right? So here in the right hand side, you can see we have a figure which is showing you the concept of vapor pressure. Now consider a system, right? Now you have to consider a system that contains only one component and is considered the simplest type of hydrocarbon system. The word component refers to the number of molecular or atomic species present in the substance. And a single component system is composed entirely of one kind of atom or molecule. And we often use pure component to describe the single component system, right? Now here you have, in this figure, you consider a closed evacuated container that has been partially filled with pure component in the liquid state. So in this figure, you can see that we have the partially filled liquid or pure component of liquid. So initially, when you just closed it, what you will see that the molecule of the liquid are in constant motions with different velocities. And when one of these molecules reaches the liquid surface, it may possess a sufficient kinetic energy to overcome the attractive forces within the liquid system, right? So once a liquid molecule at somewhere bottom will go up, and if it possesses sufficient kinetic energy, it may move up, right? And the molecule, as I said, the molecule of liquid are in constant motion with different velocities. So when one of these molecules reaches to the liquid surface, as I said, it may possess sufficient kinetic energy to overcome the forces, right? So the forces are the attractive forces in the liquid itself. And once it overcome the forces, it passes into vapor space above, right? So above you can see there is a space, the liquid molecules, the gaseous molecules, by evaporation, the liquid molecule go to the vapor molecule. And as the number of molecules in the vapor phase increases, as you can see in the right hand side of this beaker, so as soon as the time passes, the number of molecules in the vapor phase is increasing, and the rate of return of liquid phase also increase, right? So as more and more molecule of gas will go to the top, again the this liquid molecule, the gaseous molecule will try to come into the liquid phase again. So more and more molecule of gaseous going into the gaseous phase, and this gaseous phase in latter part of time will again start going into the liquid phase. That means that at certain point of time, there must be some equilibrium which is achieved, and no more gas will go into liquid phase and no more liquid will go into the gaseous phase. Now, if such type of things are established, you can say that you have the pressure at the surface of the liquid, which is known as vapor pressure. So vapor pressure is nothing but it's equilibrium pressure existing between the vapor phase and the liquid phase inside a beaker, right? So this is the concept of vapor pressure. Now there are various charts which are available, because vapor pressure is directly related to the temperature. Now since it is related to the temperature, we have various charts given by Cox, which will allow us to find out for various components the vapor pressure at different temperatures, right? Now the problem here is that when you are going to do some kind of numerical simulations or is in a spreadsheet calculation, you cannot do it by chart. So you need some empirical relationship, and these empirical relationship are given by Lee and Kessler in 1975, who proposed that this pressure PV, which is called vapor pressure, can be calculated by the expression shown here, that PV equal to PC exponential A plus omega P. Now omega is the eccentric factor, which depends on the type of gas, and A and B are nothing but some constant which depend on the temperature, reduced temperature. So now you want to find out the reduced temperature, so you must have the idea of the critical temperature for that particular gas or fluid, right? So this is the concept of vapor pressure. Now coming back to our equilibrium ratio concept, where we try to find out the amount of liquid and amount of gas that is flashing out from incoming well stream, right? So now we'll talk about not a pure substance, but we talk about multi-component system. Now in a multi-component system, the equilibrium ratio Ki for a given component is defined as the ratio of mole fraction of the component in the gaseous phase, that is Yi, right? So Ki is nothing but Yi divided by Xi, whereas Yi is the mole fraction of component in the gaseous phase, and Xi is the mole fraction of that component in the liquid phase, right? So this equilibrium ratio can be calculated using Rawls and Dalton's law as described below. Now you see, the Rawls law state that the partial pressure I of a component in a multi-component system, right, is the product of its mole fraction of liquid phase Xi and the vapor phase of the component PVI, right? So PVI is the vapor pressure, which need to be calculated either by chart or either by the relation I have shown, right? So you must have an idea of the component system, and for each component you know the PVI, and then you can evaluate this PVI for a single component system. And this PI, that is partial pressure of that component, can be calculated if you have an idea of mole fraction of that component in the liquid phase, right? So throughout our calculation, we want to find out this Xi and PI, Xi and Yi. Now in this Rawls law, you see this PI equal to Xi PVI, that is the product of mole fraction of liquid phase Xi and the vapor pressure of that component PVI. Now there is another law which is called Dalton's law, and which state that the partial pressure of the component is the product of mole fraction in the gaseous phase and the total pressure of the system, right? So this PI is equal to Yi into P. Now this here P is the total pressure of the system, not the vapor pressure. Now at equilibrium condition, these two PI are same. So at equilibrium, Xi PVI, at equilibrium, this Xi PVI is equal to YiP. Yes.
When we talk about equilibrium condition, we mean that the liquid and gas will be state. No liquid will change to gas and no gas will change to liquid.
See, when the equilibrium is established, the amount of liquid, right, that is going into vapor phase and the amount of vapor phase that is going into liquid phase will become equal. And you can say that there is no further exchange, right? And that is the condition of equilibrium. And at that point of time, the pressure, whatever pressure exerted by vapor on that liquid is the vapor pressure, right? And there are two laws which actually give the value of PVI and relates that PVI with the total pressure is the Dalton's law and Raoult's law. So at equilibrium, these two laws becomes equal, that is the partial pressure exerted by a component in the gas phase must be equal to the partial pressure exerted by same component in liquid phase, right? So in that case, XI PVI equal to YIP, and therefore from here we can find out the equilibrium ratio KI, right? Getting?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, so here you can see we have KI. Now this KI is very important parameter, very, very important parameter, and we always want to find out this KI, right? So now here you know the ratio of what is YI? What is YI? Omar? Double?
It is the mole fraction.
Mole fraction of component in gaseous phase, right? Yes. And XI is the mole fraction of that
in
component
vapor.
In liquid.
In liquid, sorry.
Right? Yeah. So YI is vapor, XI is liquid. Just remember that. And okay, if you know this ratio somehow, right? You can do some kind of flash calculation to find out number of mole in liquid phase and number of mole in vapor phase, right? So this is our objective. So our objective is to do some flash calculation where we want to find out how much vapor that is going or that has flashed into liquid gaseous phase and how much liquid that has flashed into liquid phase, right? So we want to find out that value, and for calculating that value, this equilibrium ratio concept is very important, right? Okay, so let's move along. Now you can see this KI. Now we are discussing the ideal solution, and in this ideal solution, this KI is dependent on YI by XI. This is the formula, and from this formula you can see that this YI by XI is given by PVI divided by P. So somehow if you find out this PVI of that component, right? So this PVI can be found out by the Cox chart or by relationship that we have seen. So if you know this PVI and this total pressure of the system, you can find out KI. So you have an idea of KI, right? That is equilibrium ratio. So for below 100 psi, as you can see, below 100 psi, you can use this relation very effectively and comfortably with no issue, right? So just by having the value of vapor pressure of that component and the total pressure of the system, you can find out KI, right? So this is about equilibrium ratio, right? Now, if you have a pressure higher than 100 psi, then
when we say about pressure, when it's below 100 psi, we are talking about the PVI or P?
No, we are talking about P, total pressure.
P.
Yes.
Okay.
Right. So when the total pressure of the system is 100 psi, you can use this relationship very comfortably. Now, when it is more than 100 psi, then we have some different relationship given by standing, right? We'll see that. Now, here I have in this figure, I have shown that if you have one mole of feed which is coming from the well, that is getting flashed into vapor and that is getting flashed into liquid, right? And if you talk about one mole of feed only, one mole of feed, then what you will see that this N will become 1, right? In this equation. So NL plus NV will become 1. That means one mole of feed is coming and this one mole is changing into NV and NL. So we need to find out these value first, right? NV and NL. So for getting this value, the flash calculations are done, right? Now you see in below equation, you have ZI, that is the mole fraction of the component in the entire hydrocarbon mixture. So we'll see with a calculation more exactly what is ZI. Now here this ZI into N, now N is 1 now. So if you go to the next slide, what you will see that this NL plus NV is equal to 1. 1 more is the initial feed you are getting. Now ZI is the mole fraction of the component in entire hydrocarbon mixture, right? So I am talking about a single component now, not the whole component. So ZI is for only one component system, right? So here you can see we have two different equations. Number one is this and number two is this, right? Now one more thing to note is that the mole fraction of the entire component, right, is equal to, if you talk about different component in a hydrocarbon stream, the mole, total mole fraction of all component will become 1. Similarly, the total XI is the mole fraction of component I in the liquid phase. So if we go to this particular equation, so mole component of liquid, right, is equal to 1. So if sum of all the mole fractions of the liquid component will become 1, and mole fraction of all the gaseous component will become 1. This is the relationship which need to be taken care of in the solution, and this particular equation will be utilized later. So first we'll start with this NL plus NV equal to 1. This is number 1. And second, if you have ZI, the mole component of a single component that is coming to the stream is ZI, and is divided into this fraction now, XI into NL and YI into NL. The feed which is coming is 1 mole, right? And this is divided into liquid phase and gaseous phase. So once it is 1 mole only, then the number of mole that is going into liquid is NL, and number of mole that is going into vapor is NV, right? Now if it is ZI, now what is ZI? ZI is the total number of moles or total fraction of that component in the incoming feed, right? And XI is the mole fraction in the liquid phase, and YI is the in the gaseous phase, right? So this is the initial equation that we have. Now you see this equation can be written in this form also. Now what is YI? YI is nothing but YI divided by XI equal to KXI, as we have seen in the equilibrium ratio. So if you know the equilibrium ratio, you can substitute the value of YI, and then what you will get is that XI into NL plus XI into KI into NV must be equal to ZI, right? So this is our expression now, and this expression can further be written as XI, which is nothing but mole fraction of component I in the liquid phase, right? So if it is coming XI, you just keep in your mind that is for liquid, right? Sometimes it's very confusing because this is equation. And so XI is the mole fraction of component liquid phase, and this can be evaluated by this formula, right? Here. And again, you know, YI is nothing but XI into KI, and this YI is given by ZI into KI divided by NL plus NV, right? Now what you have here is both the mole fraction of component I in the liquid phase and mole fraction of the component I in the gaseous phase, right? So you have these two quantities. Now as you know that summation of all the mole fraction of component, right? So if you have different components which is going into the liquid phase, and so that total summation will become 1, right? And the total summation again for gaseous phase is 1. So what you have is the summation of sigma xi is equal to zi divided by nl plus nv into ki. So this is nothing but from this equation you see you have just substituted it, right? Now what if you just use this equation, if you have an idea that this sigma xi equal to 1 and sigma yi equal to 1, what you can do is just subtract these two, right, in this equation. And then what you'll get next is this equation, right? And further, this equation can be written in this form, right? So this is just a simplification of this. And see, one more thing, that NV, you replace this NV or NL, right? So in place of NL, you can substitute NV. So this NL equal to 1 minus NV. Just put that value in this equation and you have a final equation called this, right? So this equation must be equal to 0, right? So we need to find out the value of NV first, right? And for using this equation, you must have the value of KI. And ZI, we can find out from the gas chromatography analysis, where we can find out individual component present in the gas stream, right? So ZI we know, KI we know, just we have to find out the value of NV so that this summation of all the component will become zero, right? So this is a kind of iterative analysis where you want to find out NV so that this equation satisfies, right? So here the above set of equation provide the necessary phase relationship to perform volumetric and compositional calculations on hydrocarbon systems, right? And these calculations are referred to as flash calculation. So the outcome based on all this equation you will see is equation given in the last. And this equation need to be satisfied if you want to find out the value of number of moles in vapor. So number of moles in vapor is calculated using this equation, and we see how the number of steps are used to find out the value of NV, right? So here, up to here, what we have seen is that these flash calculations are used in all reservoir and process engineering calculation, and soon we'll see some numerical based on this. I have prepared one Excel sheet where we do this numerical, and we'll see how this equation is not very much complex as it is seen by the equation. Now you see, it is needed to know the amount of hydrocarbon liquid and gas coexisting in the reservoir, right? So we always need the amount of hydrocarbon liquid and the gas that is coexisting in the reservoir or a vessel that is separator. And we want to determine this hydrocarbon liquid and gas which is present. So that is why we are doing this calculation, right? So now here, performing this calculation, we want these values, NV, that is mole of gas phase, moles of liquid phase, and then the composition of liquid phase and the composition of gaseous phase. Now these following steps have been suggested to find out all these factors. So as I said, this is an iterative process, right? So you have to put different value of NV in the previous equation that we have seen so that this will become zero, right? So what is the first step is that you have to assume an arbitrary value of NV. Suppose you have chosen 0 to 1, right? And from 0 to 1, you take any value of NV. So this is a kind of Newton-Raphson method that will apply here. And this NV, you choose 0.5, suppose. Now you have to next evaluate the function FNV, that is the previous equation in the previous slide. So first you have to evaluate the function NV using this value of NV that you have taken as 0.5. Now, if the absolute value of function NV is smaller than preset tolerance, right? Now, this preset tolerance is roughly around, you said, 10 to the power minus 15. that is almost zero, right? So if the preset tolerance is around 10 power minus 15, this function fnv is equal to zero, and it is satisfied using that value of 0.5. Therefore, that is the desired solution. Now, if it is not coming to with the preset tolerance, that is, it is greater than the preset tolerance, what does it mean? It means that you need to have a new value of nv, right? And this new value of nv cannot be taken randomly, but we use the Newton-Raphson method to find out the value of nv. Now, this Newton-Raphson method says that this new value of nvn, right? So earlier we have taken 0.5. Now this, we want the second value of nv, which is more closer to the right value. So this nvn is equal to nv minus fnv divided by differentiation of that previous equation, and which is nothing but f dash is equal to minus sigma and this function, right? So you can see that, and we'll see soon one numerical based on this, so that you have a good idea how we find out different quantities using this equation. Now let us take this example. Now this example says that hydrocarbon mixture with the following overall composition is flashed in a separator. Now you have a separator, you have an initial feed that is coming in to the separator, and that separator is at 50 psi and 100 degree Fahrenheit temperature, right? Now 50 psi is well below 100 psi, so we can use the equation given by Dalton's law and Raoult's law, where this Ki is nothing but PVI divided by P, right? So this PVI divided by P is to be known, and once it is known, you can easily do the calculation. Now see what the compositions given are: C3, IC4, NC4, IC5 and C6. All these components are there in the incoming stream, right? And the mole fraction of these individual component that is coming, right? So let us take this pen to clearly show you that Cn, the initial component. So what, whenever I say Zi, I am talking about a single component that is coming from incoming stream. Although that incoming stream has different components, but I am talking about only single component, C3, that is methane propane. So the propane is having a mole fraction of 0.2 in that incoming stream, right? So for propane, what is the PVI? What is the PVI at 100 degree Fahrenheit? And this can be, either you can use the relationship I have shown you by Kessler, or either you can go to the Cox chart. Okay, so the Cox chart I have not taken in this particular discussion. You can see it is given in book by Tariq Ahmed, and you can see here that this PVI is nothing but 190, right, psi coming for this propane at 100 degree Fahrenheit. So it's a temperature dependent quantity. If temperature changes, this value will also change, right? So we have different value of PVI, and the pressure is already known, that is 50 psi, and then you can use that relationship, that is Ki equal to PVI divided by P, right? So you can find out this Ki, right? Now what we have to do is that first we have to find out the fnv, right? So you need all these parameters, okay? So you have to take some random value of nv, and then you can take this function. So this function is shown here, fnv, and we have taken some random value of nv, and all these are the calculations shown here, right? So these are the calculation to find out and to be substituted in fnv and fn dash v, right? So our objective is that this fnv should be zero, right? So we want this to be zero, right? So we have done number of iteration here. You can see number of iteration is performed, and initially we have taken the value of nv to be zero, right? So the next value is 0.895, which is calculated using this equation, right? This equation. So the next value is found out using this equation NVN. So initial value is 0. Then we have put the value of FNV calculated from this equation, putting at this value as 0. And then you can find out the value of F dash NV using this equation. And therefore, you have a new value of NV. So this is the new value. Okay, second value. So this is the first value. This is the first. This is the second, this is the third, this is the fourth, this is the fifth, and so on, until you reached a value where you got FNV equal to 0. So you see that once you have a value of 0.108, in that value of NV, you got FNV as 0. So it's a kind of iterative process. Now I will show you. Hello, yes.
So when we find the values, you said that we will take randomly values for NV.
Yes.
This is for the first one.
Yeah, first value can take random, right?
0, which is now is 0.
0. And next value will come from, see, once you put the value 0, you get some FNV. Now, if that FNV is not 0, right?
Yes.
Then you
so have, first we will take... We will assume only the first value of NV, which is 0. So we will get NV.
Here we have taken 0, but you can take it 0.5 also. No problem.
But it must be less than 1.
It must be lying between 0 and 1. Okay. Because you know mole fraction. It is mole fraction, right?
Yes, sir.
NV.
Okay.
Right. So I am showing you in one spreadsheet calculation. 1 minute, just a minute. So can you see this? All of you?
Yes.
Okay. Now here, this is the spreadsheet that I have shown just now. Here you see this initial value is 0, right? Let us make this value, I am copying this here. Just Control C and putting it here, right? So this is nothing but your N and FNV, right? Okay, now let us make it some random value 0.5, right? So you see FNV has changed. Right? Please say. Please unmute your mic.
Okay, I was talking while the mic was muted. Yes, okay, sir, this is changing.
Just please unmute your mic for some time, right? Now, now you see this value of NV is 0.5, FNV is this, right? What do you want? You want this FNV to be 0, right? Now this FNV will be 0. You need to find out the other value of NV. So you cannot take the NV as random you want, right? So you want some value so that your final solution converges to 0.
So I will use...
So then you have to find out FNV, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So first what you do, that you find out FNV and then you go back to this equation. This one. Can you see this?
Yes, sir.
So NVN, new value of NV is equal to NV, that is 0.5 that you have taken, minus FNV that you have calculated, right?
And F dash NV.
Right? Or you can do one more method, right? See, there is one more method of goal seeking. Now here you can see at the top that you go to the data, and use this what if analysis of goal seeking, right? So what is the goal? You have to reduce this FNV to 0, right? So set the value J15. So we have put this value here. Now you want the value to be 0 by changing this value, right? This. So this will do automatic calculation for you. So you see, what is the value you got? This one. And this is already matching with this, right?
Yes, sir.
So this is another method. You don't have to do so much calculation. Just by clicking what if analysis and goal sheet, you have this value of NB, right? So this is the power of software and Excel.
Exactly. Right?
And let us go to our slide. Now here you see, this is the simple calculation where you have found out the value of NV, right? So NV is known now. Now how you can find out NL is 1 minus NV, right? So now the amount of liquid and amount of vapor that is splashed by incoming fluid is known now.
Yes.
Very simple. Now see, next calculation, what you can do, you can find out XI also, XI and YI. What is XI?
The mole fraction of the vapor.
Yes, more, mole fraction of the liquid. XI is liquid, right?
Sorry, liquid, yeah.
Yeah, so it is mole fraction of liquid.
Liquid.
Component I, only I component I am saying, right? So see, XI value for each component is shown here. Right, I am enlarging the screen, right? 1 minute, yes. So this XI value for each component is shown here. Can you see that? These values for individual component we have calculated, right?
Yes.
So XI for C3, that the amount of propane that is in liquid condition, right, because of that pressure is 0.1533, and amount of in gaseous phase is YI, right? So it is a mole fraction in of that component in liquid state and in gaseous state. It is already calculated here, right? So in this way the flash calculation are performed, and this calculation actually give you the idea that what is the amount of component that is present in gaseous phase and what is the amount of component that is present in liquid phase. So based on that, you can predict how much liquid and how much gas you are going to get out of that separation. And you can qualitatively tell anyone that this is the amount of liquid that I am going to get and this is the amount of vapor I am going to get. And this is the composition I am going to get, right? So you are in the position right now to tell anyone the mole fraction that is present in vapor phase and the mole fraction that is present in liquid phase and the mole fractions of individual component also you can tell anyone, right? And once you have this idea, you can find out different things like gas oil ratio, you can find out the molecular weight of the gaseous component, and you can also find the molecular weight of the liquid component. Then you can also find out the density of the liquid. Then you can also find the density of vapor. So lot of things you can find out just by doing these calculations, right? So we have seen how we can find out different values, and once you have an idea of this equation, this is very simple for you to calculate. It's not very big deal. Only equations are little bit awkward. Only thing you have to just feel it, that how we can find out and what we are going to get. What we are going to get is number of moles in vapor, number of moles in liquid, and individual component, right, in gaseous phase and in vapor phase. So a qualitative picture is with you now, and you can tell anyone what is the component I am getting in gaseous phase and what is the component I am getting in liquid phase. So this is the power of flash calculation, right? Understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'll ask you to do one calculation on your own, so that you can feel this all equations. So what is all this equation is telling you, right? So if you have any doubt, any queries, you just ask.
Thank you, sir. Clear.
Clear? As I said, just unmute your mic now. You can talk to me. Right? Now see, as I have said, that if the pressure is less than 100 psi, you use this equation of given by Dalton law. And if it is greater than 1000 psi, it is lower than 1000 psi, then what you have to do? You have to use the relationship given by Standing in 1979, where you can see this Ki value, which we need for flash calculation, dependent on the pressure value and some constant.
Fi. Yeah,
AC and FI. AC, A plus C plus into FI, right? So this equation is very important in finding out the value of Ki. So Ki is dependent on the pressure of the system, and C FI is dependent on the temperature, right? So you need few things like temperature, pressure, critical temperature, and the boiling point of the liquid to find out the value of Ki, because this value of Ki is very important in flash calculation determination. So if this value go wrong, your whole calculation will go wrong. So you have to find out this, right? So yes, I'll give you one. Yes,
this is in case if the system pressure is greater than 100 psi, yes, and less than 1000 psi.
Less than 1000.
What if it is more than 1000 psi?
For that we have different relationship, but generally, as I said,
okay,
so generally the pressure varies in separator from 600 to 1200 psi. So in that case we can use this equation comfortably, and there is no need for any other relationship. However, there are many relationships which are given in textbook. You can use that equations, right? So we have different empirical relationship given for different practical pressures, which are generally found in separator conditions, right? So I want to highlight this, and I should say thank you and take care. Next we'll discuss the separator design detail and dehydration, right? Thank you very much, students, for having this class. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.